This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
And welcome, church family. I want to encourage you today. If you've been praying for something, maybe for years, and you haven't seen a breakthrough, don't give up. Keep praying. The Bible says to pray continually, and it would not say that if everything we prayed for happened instantly all the time. Prayer changes things. Don't give up. Keep praying, child of God. Would you turn around and shake the hand of the person next to you and say, God loves you, and so do I.
Well, today's going to be a great day, and way to go. You're in the house of the Lord. Things are going to be good today. Things are going to be good this week, and we're going to go into this week with faith, right? Not with worry. We're going to go trust in God that not only are things going to be great, they're going to be above and not beneath, that God's going to make you the head and not the tail, that He's going to give you everything you need to endure and press through to victory. Amen? So that's what we're coming today, to realign our minds with the Word of God. And we're so grateful that you're here. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you've called us here, that we're your guests, and we love you so much. We pray, God, in Jesus' name, Lord, that you would align our minds and our hearts with the Word of God. We thank you that good things are coming, and we trust you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated. In preparation for Bobby's message, the words of our Lord found in Matthew. When Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, asking for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home, paralyzed, suffering terribly. Jesus said to him, shall I come and heal him? The centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes, and that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he was amazed, and he said to those following him, truly, I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. I say to you that many will come from the east and the West, and will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, "Go, let it be done just as you believed it would." And his servant was healed at that moment. We, church family, are praying with faith, not sympathy. We are waiting with faith, not worry. And we are acting with faith, not second guessing. Amen.
Thank you so much, choir. Well, we're so happy to have Anthony Evans in the house today, and he was here 7 years ago at the Crystal Cathedral, and Anthony's a talented singer and a worship leader, and he's found success in both Hollywood and the church, letting his faith lead him in his work. So would you welcome with me Anthony Evans?
Thank you.
Hi.
Hey.
So great to see you.
Glad to be here. Really glad to be here. Thank you.
So you were on the Hour of Power 7 years ago, and then you were on The Voice, and that sort of opened up a whole world for your ministry and your your life. That was maybe 5-6 years ago.
Yeah, five or six.
So what's been going on in your life since then? I mean, your whole career is really taking off.
It was redirected just a little bit. I'm so grateful for being a preacher's kid and growing up in church and everything, but that was a little bit different than church, you know, slightly.
Your dad's Tony Evans, a pastor in Dallas, big pastor.
So it was amazing for me to do something outside of the four walls of church. I remember calling my dad when I got the call to do The Voice and feeling like something was wrong. I was like, can I do this? Is this okay? You know, because it was so different. And he said, as long as you don't compromise your faith, have a great time. And so I went and did that and was on Christina Aguilera's team. And I remember her sitting down with me when we first started the show at her house, and she said, okay, this you lead worship. Now, what is that? Like, explain that to me. And in that moment, because I was using churchy words, and she was looking at me like, what are you talking about? Yeah. I realized I should know how to speak and how to interact with somebody who does not live within these four walls. And so it created a passion in me to start to broaden what I do.
So you you're hanging out with Christina Aguilera. She's cool.
She's amazing.
And Jewel, you also, I mean, you had an experience with a number of different musicians. And now being, you know, growing up in Texas, right? Mm-hmm. And being a worship leader and then being on The Voice, and then now you live in Hollywood and you're really singing in LA as a Christian, but not always too Christian. So mm-hmm. working with, you know, everyday big performers like that, you know, I know you want to have an impact on their lives. Have they had an impact on your life?
Oh, 100%. Christina did in many different ways. And then on the show, Jewel was an advisor of mine, and she sat down with me and said, okay, I get it. You're a preacher's kid. You grew up in church. But to me, that's the tip of the iceberg. And I need to know what's going on underneath the surface of you, because I don't necessarily, and a lot of people here won't resonate with all that information. So I need to know. I need you to be authentic, vulnerable, and transparent, and tell us more of your story so we can connect there, and it'll be like a cumulative part of who you are. So it really made me want to just communicate authentically and be about relationship and not just about the knowledge I have of my faith initially.
You know? Yeah. What's a way in which you were vulnerable?
Man, well, this whole new album, it's called Back to Life, and honest lyrics, not just writing things so that people's ears are tickled or that I'm doing the cliche stuff to make sure that I'm resonating. And there was a point, one of the ways I was being a preacher's kid, we can get used to coming indoors, shaking hands, kissing babies, you know, making everybody think everything's all right.
Yeah.
I had to get to a point where I had to be authentic about the fact that this wasn't necessarily resonating with me all the way. I sat down with my dad and I felt left, lost, abandoned. I had gone through a broken engagement, but then had to go lead worship the next day, which that's not a fun feeling. It didn't feel great.
Yeah.
But I felt left and lost and abandoned. And my dad said, "You have got to realize that your feelings don't have intellect." And as real as
it
feels, he said, "You have to realize that your feelings do not have intellect. You always have to bounce them off of the truth. They can be the caboose. They cannot be the engine." So I had to be honest with where I was at that moment. Mm-hmm. And through that honesty and vulnerability, I have found deeper connections with people because they resonate with me because their story involves some kind of heartbreak or kind of, you know? So it's been very encouraging, the stories that have come through.
So as an artist, you approach your newest album in that way where you really just want to be vulnerable, and it's not all like the typical lyrics always that you get in Christian albums. So there's a lot of your heart in there, and
that's what I want to do.
Well, your album just came out, and I know it's an amazing album. Go check it out, and I know we'll be blasting it through the house on my little Sonos.
Okay, awesome.
Okay, looking forward.
That's great. Yeah.
But thank you so much. And what you're going to be singing for us today, and what's the song that you're singing?
I'm going to do a couple of them. Your Great Name is a song I recorded a few years ago on an album called Home, and then See You Again is the first single from the album Back to Life that just came out, and so I'm really excited. Awesome. We're excited to be here.
It is really such an honor to have you here, Anthony, and would you please welcome with me Anthony Evans. God bless you.
Yeah, thanks again.
Lost or saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, they feel no shame at the sound. Souls.
God is moving in miraculous ways through Hour of Power, thanks to our faithful Eagle partners who provide the foundational support our ministry needs. We're able to continue sharing God's love and dignity with the world. Please prayerfully consider becoming an Eagle partner today with a monthly gift of $50 or a one-time gift of $600. As a thank you for your gift, Bobby will send you our recent book, Releasing Joy. This leather-bound 52-week devotional book features inspirational scripture and teachings from Bobby for every week of the year. As a Golden Eagle partner, with your gift of $100 a month or a one-time gift of $1,200, Bobby will send you a copy of Releasing Joy with your name beautifully embossed on the cover. Your steadfast support enables our ministry to maintain and extend its reach around the world. Call, write, or go online to become an Eagle partner today. We are so thankful for you.
I've seen darkness shattered by light. I've seen joy break after the night. I wanna see it again. I've seen tragic and hopeless days turn to stories of amazing grace. I want to see it again. Oh, come, Lord, like a rushing wind. We are desperate for your presence. Revive us by your spirit within. We want to see you. Strength rise to persevere. I want to see it again. I've seen bodies ruined and frail rise in power. Greater. spirit within. We want to see you again, see you again. We want to see you again, see you
again. Welcome. We're so glad you're here. Thank you for joining us today, and we believe God has a word for you. If you live in Orange County or LA, come down and worship with us. We'd love to meet you. If you've got kids or a nephew or something, bring them. We'll teach them the things of God. And I want to shake your hand and give you a big old hug. So Hannah and I would love to meet you, so please come down to Shepherd's Grove. This is a place that believes in the dignity of every single human being. You belong here, even before you believe. Well, friends, we say this creed every single Sunday, and I'm going to invite you to do it. Would you hold your hands out like this as a sign of receiving? We're going to say this together. I am not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Thanks, you can be seated. And that is your greatest treasure. Your greatest treasure is that you're treasured by a loving and a good God. And man, is that the truth. He treasures you. And today we're going to talk about faith. Faith is trusting the word of God, that it is true, that God is for you, that God loves you, that God will bless you, and you believe that. You are a person who trusts in God and not in this world. And you will endure in that faith. And as you do, all of heaven will open up to bless you with opportunity, with favor, with forgiveness, with wisdom. Good things are coming. So to trust in God, we have to believe that God actually believes in us, that God really does love us, that he does trust that in creating you, he made something pretty spectacular. Most of us don't believe that deep down inside. You do, but a lot of us struggle with that. To have faith in God means to have faith that God has the best for us in mind, that God wants us to go to heaven, that God wants us to thrive, that God wants us to do well, and he does. I remember when I was a kid, I went to this Baptist school. And it was a great school, actually. I had a great experience. But, you know, every batch of apples has got a rotten one in it somewhere. And I had this teacher, and she sat us all down. I think I was in fourth or fifth grade, which means I had to be maybe 10. You know, we're kids. And we sit down, and we're learning a Bible study about Noah. And she asked the class, how did God destroy the world the first time? And we said, with the flood. He destroyed the world with the flood. And then she said, and what is the rainbow? It's a promise that he won't destroy the world again. She's like, no, it's a promise that he won't destroy the world again with a flood. I'm like, oh, okay. And she goes, so what does that mean? What does that mean? We don't know. That he's going to destroy the world again with fire. She didn't say it like that, but she said, he's going to destroy the whole world with fire. We're like, oh, he's going to destroy the world with, that's what the rainbow means. They're like, yeah. And she said, you know, God will burn things to purify them. I'm like, I don't know about that. But she said, okay. And she said, and that's what hell is. Hell is where you will go if you don't confess all your sins. And so we were like, okay. And she's like, in other words, basically what she said was, and she kept going on this, if you don't confess every single sin you've ever done at the point of your death, you go to hell. Like, you've got to not only remember them all, that'd be hard for me. I got a lot. You got to remember them all, and you got to confess them. And like, so if I pull my sister's hair and then, you know, she stabs me to death, that's it. I'm going to hell. But she can confess it and go to heaven. And anyway. So this is a problem for me because it was a dialogue about the character and the nature of God. I mean, to me, that sounds like God's a mean old man looking to throw me into hell, looking for any reason to get me to go to hell. And one little thing, he's going to get me, huh? So I talked to my mom about this, and she said, that's stupid. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. She goes, "Here, no, you're saved by grace, not by your works. And you don't have to worry about confessing every sin. It's good to confess your sins. You should do that. It's good for you. It's going to make you a better person. It's going to make you a more Jesus kind of person. But God is not a cranky old man looking to throw you into hell. There is a hell. There is a heaven. But I guarantee you that there is no one in the whole universe that wants you to go to heaven and not to hell more than God. If you can't believe that, how can you trust in God? How can you? God is a loving Father, and He wants you to choose Him. He wants you to be in heaven when you die. And more than that, He wants heaven to open up to you right now. God wants you to live a thriving, good life. If it is good, it is from God. If it is not good, it is not from God. God gives only what is good. He does not give what is not good for you. He loves you. And if we talk about having faith in the character of someone who doesn't have character, that's not faith. Faith in God is not just believing in Him, it's trusting that God's ways are better than my ways, not only for God, but for me. Look, if my ways for my children are better for my kids than my kids' ways for my kids. Amen? All right, so God will ask us and command us to do things we don't want to do, but part of living by faith is trusting that that's the best way to be. Loving your enemies takes a lot of faith. To love your enemies is trusting that that's the best thing for me, for God, and for my enemy. It's the best thing, even though it's a terrible, horrible thing to do. Who wants to love their enemy, huh? But it's amazing, and it requires faith. So, too often, we take our own vices, you know, our resentment, our anger, and we project it on God. Voltaire said this famous criticism. He said, in the beginning, God created man in His own image, and man has been trying to repay the favor ever since. We try and project all of our stuff onto God. He's not that way. God is love. And if you hear anything I say now, this is one of the most Christian things you could say. Jesus shows us what God is like. Jesus does not go around making people sick. He goes around healing people. Jesus does not go around telling people they're stupid. He goes around teaching people. Jesus is a friend of sinners. Thank you, Jesus. I need a friend like that. So do you. And you have a friend like that. You can trust in God that He's on your side, that He's with you, and you do. You've put your trust in God, and it's made all the difference. Keep faith alive in Him. He will not abandon you because you messed up. He will not abandon you because you doubt from time to time. He will not abandon you. He's not looking to trip you up. He's on your side. He loves you. And trusting in God begins there, that He loves us, not for what we do, not for what we have, and not for our reputation. He just loves us because He does, because He's our dad. Dads love their kids. God loves you. So put your faith in God and continue to do it. Put your faith in Jesus Christ. He'll never let you down. Faith is to trust that in the midst, and life is hard, I know, we suffer. Really unfair, horrible things can happen in life, but faith is the trust that in the end, the good is going to so far outweigh the bad, it will make sense. It will. It will. So carry on. Keep faith alive. In Matthew chapter 8, today's scripture reading, we read the story about the famous story of the centurion. And in Jesus' days, centurions were not religious people. They were not liked by the religious elite. They were outsiders. They were enemies. They were pagans. They worshipped pagan gods. They went to pagan festivals. They observed pagan sexual rites, among other bizarre things that were very Roman in those days. So they were not considered men of faith, huh? They were not considered godly men. They didn't consider themselves godly men. They were practical. They were military men. And the centurion, in particular, was hated because, well, he was a soldier. And in those days, the Roman Empire occupied Israel. And although Israel was a vassal in the sense that it got to have its own puppet king and, you know, have its own cultures and laws, there was always the Roman Empire looking over them. They hated that. In the temple, there was this, if you look in the old, the temple was the center of Jewish life, and just next to the temple, attached to it, was a giant fortress, higher than the temple, called Antonia Fortress, and there there would be a garrison of Roman troops with bows and arrows ready to fire on the people in the temple if anybody got out of line. So there was this dominant, tyrannical rule of the Roman Empire. So the Jews hated the Romans. They were outsiders. So here's this new Jewish rabbi, this hero, this people are calling him a prophet. He's going around healing people and he's preaching and he's obviously anointed by God. And yet there's something really annoying about him, and that's that he's inviting people to the table that aren't supposed to be there. It's bugging people. So here, and in their narrative, you have to remember that in the Septuagint, in the apocryphal literature rather, there is a story that after the Jewish people slay all the enemies in warfare, they will gather for this massed feast where the most pure, most holy will eat of the behemoth and leviathan. It's this kind of heavenly end of the world image. So hold that in your mind as we get into the story. So the evil pagans, they'll be dead or cast outside where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth, but the religious elite will be at the table. The centurion comes to Jesus. And he says, Lord, my servant is sick. He's paralyzed. He needs you. I need you to heal him. And Jesus says, you want me to come to your house and heal him? And the centurion says, no, Lord, I'm not worthy to have you under my roof. I tell this man, go, and he goes. I tell him to come, and he comes. And they do it. Simply say the word, and it will be so. Now what Jesus says is offensive. He says, not in all of Israel have I seen such faith as this man. He says, I tell you that at the table in the end of time, many will come, that's pagans, many will come from the east and from the west, but many of those who are children of the kingdom will be cast out where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. What is he saying there? That at my table, those who have faith will sit here, and those who have pride and self-righteousness will not. And he says to this man, your servant is well. And on that day, he was made well. For the centurion, all he needed was a word from God. That's it. He didn't need him to come to his house. He didn't need him to lay hands on him. He just had faith in the word of God that it was true. And that is central to the Christian belief, is that faith is what saves us. Not our works. We respond in our works to faith, but in the end, it's every day trusting that God is faithful, God is true, that God will do the saving, that everything I do in life is an assistance to Him, that He's the one doing the work, and I'm along for the ride. That's faith, and that's how you live. You've lived every moment of your life with faith. When you went through struggles, you said, I trust in God. When you went through difficult times, when you got sick, you said, I trust in God. When you didn't have the money to pay your bills, you said, I trust in God. When you were feeling riddled with shame and guilt, you said, I trust in God. Keep trusting in Him. God is faithful. God is faithful. He loves you, and He is on your side. He's on your side. Believe it. God is not punishing you. He's not. He's going to bless you, and He is blessing you. And blessings are coming for you, and heaven is opened up to you. Just respond
with faith. Amen.
So, it's all about faith. It's all about you making a choice to trust in God. No one else can make that decision for you. You have to choose to follow God. Your mom can't make it, your dad can't make it, your brother and sister can't make it, and I can't make it. Only you can make the decision to trust your life to God. And most people don't. Most people trust in the world and in society, and they put their trust in other people. But ultimately, you gotta trust in God. You can't trust anyone, even yourself, with your death, let alone your life. Trust in Him, and things will go better. Amen? That's the narrow road. That's the narrow road. Jesus talks about this narrow road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Who walks that road? Those who trust in God. Those who walk by faith and not by sight. Those who believe with all their heart that God is good, that He is faithful, and in the end, He will come through. So keep faith alive. Faith is trust. Faith is trust. And it's really just that simple. When you sat in your pew today, I doubt that you examined the pew before you sat in it. You just sat in it, right? Why? You trust it. You have faith that the pew is good, so you sit in it. Maybe not those chairs outside, but these pews here, you know. The ones outside, they're not very good, we know. We're working on it. But your pew, you didn't examine it, you didn't check it out, you just sat on it. You trust that it's strong enough to hold you, even if you had a little extra pizza last night, no problem. When you go to a green light, you go through the green light assuming that the people on either side with the red light are going to stop. How do you know they're going to stop? They could drive right through. Nothing's stopping that car. But you just know because you drive enough, they're probably going to stop. And if they don't, you're in trouble. But that's what it means to drive by faith. So already today, you've sat with faith and you drove here by faith. Today, you're going to live by faith as you always do. I think living by faith is most like flying by plane. And this is something that's personal to me. I travel all the time, and I always am just a little bit nervous when I fly. Not a lot, a little. And that's okay. I'm being vulnerable. Flying on an airplane is so astronomically safe. You're actually safer on an airplane in flight than you are sitting in your house. According to a study by MIT, you're more likely to be shot while sitting at your computer from the outside through the window or wall than you are to be in a commercial airplane crash. Flying is safer than riding on a train. If you flew every day and rode on a train every day, you would be more likely to die on a train accident 17 times than to die in a plane crash. But let me get you, I'm gonna really get you now. You ready, choir? All right. If you drive every day and you fly every day, you will die in a car accident 500 times before you die in a plane crash, statistically. You are so safe on a plane. When you get on a plane, all that information goes out the window. It just doesn't matter. I don't care. It doesn't matter. I am flying through the sky in a giant metal tube going several hundred miles an hour, and I don't even know what's happening here. Like, right? Like, I'll take my peanuts. So you're rooted in knowledge. You get on the plane because you know it's safe, but you're still nervous. But you can get on a plane and you can be nervous. In fact, you can be that gal or that guy that's like freaking out and drinking vodka and doing whatever you can to make it to the other side. Don't drink vodka. But you can be that guy in your spiritual life and still have faith as long as you get on a plane. Do you hear me? Faith is about getting on a plane. Faith is about sitting in the chair. Faith is trusting God in what you do. Faith is released. It's not had. It's released. It's what it makes you do. It's courage. Courage is doing what you're scared of, but still doing it. Faith doesn't mean you're not scared. Faith means you trust God enough to move forward. Amen? And you have faith, and I'm proud of you. I'm so proud of you that through it all, you've continued to be the person who says, above all, I trust God and not this world. I trust in God, and I'm proud of you. Keep trusting in Him. Keep your faith alive. You can trust God. He is on your side. So something good's gonna happen. Everybody say that to me. Something good's gonna happen. Something good, it's gonna happen. Something good's gonna happen, right? It's something good. And faith doesn't mean you know what the good thing is, but man, when it comes, that's gonna be, you're gonna know. You're gonna be like, Pastor Bobby said something good was gonna happen, and man, he was right. But I knew he was right because I have faith. And you do. So three things. Number one, pray with faith, not with sympathy. Pray with faith, not with sympathy. I remember when Hannah and I, we were with a small gathering of pastors in Houston, and Dottie Osteen, this beautiful but older little woman, Joel Osteen's mom, was praying for us pastors. And she prayed different than most Christians pray. When she prayed, it was like she was wrestling with God, like she was warring with God. So she's praying, and she's like, come on, God, come on. You've got to heal Cohen. How is Hannah going to do your work if Cohen is sick all the time? You've got to heal him. And she'd like pace around. Like she's not done yet. She's like, wait. She's like, come on, God, you gotta heal him. When she prayed, it was as though she actually believed God would hear her prayer and do it. It wasn't like, oh, Lord, we pray in thine holy name. No, she was like, hey. That's somebody who's praying with faith, not with sympathy. That's someone who was told that she was going to die of cancer in a month and received a miracle from God. And today, 25 years later, is walking in complete health. So, hey, look, I know people with big faith still die of cancer sometimes, but that's because something better is coming. And I just believe that. I just believe it. So when you pray, pray with faith. Believe that God will hear your prayer and that he'll do it, that he can and he will. Pray with faith. And you do. You pray with faith. You don't pray like religious folks. You pray like a girl or a guy praying to his or her dad. Because that's what you're doing. You're asking your dad for help. And he's a good dad, a loving dad, a present dad, a dad who's never abandoned you. He's your loving father. Pray to him like that. Okay. Number two, when you wait, wait with faith, not with worry. Wait with faith, not worry. Faith is so much about walking day by day than it is about leaping. Faith is about every day just trusting it's going to be all right. Faith means I don't see the future, but God does, and it's good, and I trust in him. And that's what you do. You walk, and you wait with faith. I'm so proud of you that in the suffering and the challenges of life, you wait with faith because you know God will come through because he always does. And you can. How many times do we worry about what might happen? How many times can our present be ruined because we're worried about our future? Things are fine now, but we don't know if they'll always be fine forever. So get rid of that. Stop worrying. Don't worry about what might happen. Stop spinning your wheels in your head. Just trust and relax and kick your feet up and know that God loves you just as you are, not as you should be, and he hasn't abandoned you, and it's going to be all right. Because that's the truth. That is true. It's going to be okay. Good things are coming. So when you wait, wait with faith, not with worry. And number three, when you act, act with faith, not with second guessing. Look, this is one I really believe in big time. If God has asked you to do something, do it. If God has asked you to do something, if he's asked you to put your hand to the plow, don't look back. Just do it. If God has asked you to do something, act with faith, with boldness, and with enthusiasm. Learn from Jonah. You say, well, what if it's not from God? I'm not sure if it's from God. Look, learn from Jonah. If you start going the wrong way, God will send something to you to turn you back to go towards Nineveh. He'll send you in the right direction. I just believe so much that faith pleases God that even when we accidentally put our faith in the wrong thing but still act with faith, that he's still in a way pleased. Because I don't think the biggest problem facing the church today is people acting with boldness for something they're passionate about. The biggest challenge to the church today is people wallowing in indecision and never acting. But that's a decision in and of itself. If you don't make a decision, time will make a decision for you. If you have a flight to Atlanta at 2 o'clock today and you decide not to get on that flight will leave without you. You've decided. So when you decide not to go somewhere, when you second guess, when you move towards a dream that God has given you in your heart, do it with all your heart. Do it with all your heart. And don't give up and go towards that goal and don't second guess yourself. Once you've made a decision and you believe it's from God, go for it. And eventually, if it's not where you're supposed to go, God will make it crystal clear. You won't have to guess. Amen? Yeah. Act with boldness. Look, faith pleases God. People admire boldness and enthusiasm anyway. I can tell you from experience, you can make the rest up at the end if you mess up. I've done it plenty of times. So when you pray, pray with faith, not with sympathy. When you wait, wait with faith, not with worry. And when you act, act with faith, with boldness, not with second-guessing yourself all the time. Amen? God really does speak to you. God really does speak to you through knowledge. He really does put ideas in your heart. And you're a person of faith. You've trusted your life to God. And that is a very, very good thing. Amen. I can't let you leave here without giving you the opportunity to connect with God. Today is a great day to become a Christian. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to come down so I can pray with you to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. Are you at peace with God? If you died today, do you know where you'd spend eternity? Do you come today and you've completely lost your faith? Or maybe, more likely, maybe you're watching on television or you're just visiting today and you need to make a decision to follow Christ. I'm going to invite you today to come forward and let me pray with you. I'm going to ask that whoever you are, I want you to know that nobody here, if you were to come down here, would blame you or judge you. All we would do is cheer with every angel in heaven to know that your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. So this morning, I'm not going to take a long time. Just give me two minutes. If wherever you are, every head up, everybody looking around, looking at your neighbor, looking at behind you to see if there's somebody. Look, if you're going to do something great for God, it begins with courage. Every journey with God begins with an act of courage. Doing something that scares you, huh? So today, if you want to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior and become a Christian, I want you to stand right where you are and come down here and let me give you a big hug and pray for you. Wherever you are, come down. No, stay right here. Stay here. Stay here. Just as you are. Just stand where you are. Come down. Stand up for God. Anyone, just come on down. Give it just a few more minutes. If you want to receive Christ, just stand up and come down. I'll give you a big old hug and we'll pray together. All right, guys. I'm going to pray with you. Would you just come around this way? And everyone, if you're here, when I became a Christian, you know, there was somebody giving an altar call like this, and I just sat in my seat. But that was still a time when my life was changed. So let's all pray this together. Friends, would you hold your hands out like this as a sign of receiving? And repeat after me. Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I am a new creation in you. I am the beloved of God. I'm called. I'm favored. I'm forgiven. I'm chosen. And I trust you, God. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. And in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Just go to this room. We're going to give you a little book and pray with you.
God is moving in miraculous ways through Hour of Power, thanks to our faithful Eagle partners who provide the foundational support our ministry needs. We're able to continue sharing God's love and dignity with the world. Please prayerfully consider becoming an Eagle partner today with a monthly gift of $50 or a one-time gift of $600. As a thank you for your gift, Bobby will send you our recent book, Releasing Joy. This leather-bound 52-week devotional book features inspirational scripture and teachings from Bobby for every week of the year. As a Golden Eagle partner, with your gift of $100 a month or a one-time gift of $1,200, Bobby will send you a copy of Releasing Joy with your name beautifully embossed on the cover. Your steadfast support enables our ministry to maintain and extend its reach around the world. Call, write, or go online to become an Eagle partner today. We are so thankful for you.